All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. I am Pato, your host. This is Razor Weapon Media, casting the AHGL game between CRC DIAX and NVIDIA. So those of you tuning in, we have some quick bans off the board right away. So we have Kha'Zix, Shen, Blitzcrank. Those are some pretty solid bans. I mean, Shen's pretty hard to deal with. Kha'Zix, obviously, very, very strong. We've seen him played a lot in the League Championship Series recently. And every time he's in there, he just does massive, massive damage and is a complete ridiculous distraction to the entire team and all your plans. You get late game, you just blow someone up, just wreck teams, hops in there, resets a bunch, and just next thing you know, your entire team's dead. So Blitzcrank, obviously, in the bottom lane, don't want to deal with him. Looking at the other side, Twisted Fate, Nautilus. Now, those are two pretty solid bans. When I looked across at the other team, I want to believe, actually, most of his ranked games are Twisted Fate. So that's a pretty solid ban there. And their jungler, Captain Selfish, or that's what it looked like, his match history was pretty much only Nautilus. So I'm going to assume that was a targeted ban. They did the research, too, and picked those out as their targets. And then a Malphite ban. Malphite, again, really, really solid for initiation, getting onto 80 carries, reducing a lot of their effectiveness. So good ban right there. And we've opened up right away. It looks like CRC DIAX is actually grabbing a Moomoo, as well as Erebus Wolf and Defrider are going to come right back with Ezreal Sona. So I like that pick. It's a really strong poke comp. Looking into their histories, Erebus Wolf has played a lot of Ezreal recently, so I expected him to probably pick up that champion. Defrider was playing a lot of Taric, but Sona actually is a really, really good pair for down bottom. And it looks like on the other side, CRC DIAX might be going for a little Soraka Caitlyn action here, which Caitlyn's one of those champions that's been played a lot more. Typically with Nunu, because Nunu's still on the board. Nunu's ridiculous because of Blood Boil. He can't, you know, Nunu has his limitations, but just as far as ADs and trading, you just max Blood Boil, and it's a huge, huge boost to damage. I believe I was listening to Jad on the cast, and he was talking about how it's about 1500 gold, because attack speed actually got more expensive in Season 3. So anything that gives you extra attack speed, like Blood Boil, is a ridiculously strong buff. So Nunu's become stronger because it gives you essentially like 1500 gold of extra stats. So when you go to trade with the AD in bot lane early, you know, that's what you expect. Now, as for mids, I expect them to maybe go Pantheon here. We'll have to see. I think they're going to probably wait to see what their enemy is going to pick in the mid lane, but, I mean, we'll have to wait. But Caitlyn, Soraka, pretty strong lane, very set on sustain, lasting lane, poking from range, and helping out with their team that way. On the other side, it looks like they're thinking about Singed Nocturne. I like both champions, actually. Again, sorry about the summer blockers. Typically, I do have summer blockers, but for some reason, it's not working out, so normally I would do that, but in this case, it's down, and I want to put it around with stuff, so we're just going to go raw. It looks like most of the players are hiding their summer spells if they want to. But yeah, Nocturne's actually a really good jungler. He's great for diving onto the enemy carry, especially someone like Caitlyn that likes to stay at range. Paranoia is really, really strong. 80 carries in the jungle, he can actually clear really, really fast. And as well as, like, he can get out for some really, really strong ganks. And he can get up to level 6 just about as fast as the mid lane, if depending on your build. I've actually seen Ottawa and a lot of champions go XP builds. And so what they can do with that is they can actually hit level 6 around the same time as mid lane, which is pretty scary from the jungle if you just farm it up. So that could be a strategy we see come through here. Not sure if they'll employ it. Singed up top, very, very annoying to deal with. And it looks on the other end, it looks like they're thinking about Garen Karthus. Which, I like Karthus, he's great for AoE team comps, has a lot of shred in there. Plus, Requiem helps him dominate a lot of the other lanes. I think they're thinking that he might be ever pretty confident in his matchup up top by picking Garen to go against Singed. We'll have to see. The only thing you have to do is you have to stay on Singed early and make sure that he doesn't start to stack up those items. Because once he starts to stack up his main key items, you're never going to kill him again. He's just going to become so hard to deal with. The thing is, though, is if the rest of your team can outpace him and win their lanes, then he's not necessarily effective in lane. You can almost kind of ignore him a little bit. But if he really takes off, really starts farming like crazy, and he's this unkillable tank that runs through your lines, poisons, damages everybody, then you're in a lot of trouble. So we'll see what I want to believe is going to go with. I'm guessing it's probably going to be, yeah, Katarina. I was kind of expecting that. Looking at his lineup, it was either that or Pantheon. So I like the pick. I like the team. Both very, very strong teams so far. So anyways, for those who are tuning in, they're wondering, a lot of people know who NVIDIA is. NVIDIA makes graphics cards, obviously. They do a lot of cool things. And if you're watching this, you probably chances are you have a NVIDIA graphics card in your machine. Mine's kind of old, so if they want to send me a new one, go ahead. That's fine. I'll accept one. I'll pimp NVIDIA for a while. But for right now, but a lot of you are probably wondering who's CRC DIAGS. CRC DIAGS is actually a library technology company. So they actually service like 23,000 libraries in 70 different countries, which is actually pretty cool that they have a bunch of League of Legends guys, of course, and they're interested in making a team coming out here. HGL, the After Hours Gaming League, for anybody that doesn't know about that either, HGL is a league that's centered around entirely around companies getting together. They form up teams. I actually first heard about this from my days at Google. When I was working at Google, we actually had some internal tournaments, and then for the very first league where they actually had, originally they started with StarCraft II. This is Day 9 TV's crew, if you guys are all familiar with StarCraft II. But originally they started with StarCraft II, and then League of Legends became popular. They said, "Hey, let's make a League of Legends league." The first inaugural league was Season 2, and the Google team jumped in. They did okay. But ultimately, it was taken by Amazon, I believe. I think, I believe it was Amazon versus Microsoft, I think, in the finals or something like that. And Amazon took it, which actually, funny enough, that's where I work now. I actually work at Amazon. So repping the returning winning team into season three, which it is now. But in season three, they brought on a ton of new teams. The other thing they did was instead of just having one division for League of Legends, they realized it was so popular and they had so many varying skill levels that much like StarCraft II's system, where they have S League, A League, or A League, B League, they actually have an A League and a B League for their League of Legends division. So now we have the B League. These are the B League teams. But the cool part about that too is like, if you're a company that doesn't have a lot of high level players, you don't have to have a team for the A League. You can also have a team for the B League. So they actually have a ton of teams this season. Something like, I mean, I looked really quickly, but it was probably like 20 plus teams that are involved in this season, which is really, really cool to see a bunch of different companies. They have Rockstar. I know some League of Legends teams, companies, like the IGN LoL guys, Red Baron, all those guys are involved now. Curse has a team. It's actually a really cool league and pretty fun. And so I'm actually really excited to cast these games. And I love to, I mean, here at Razor Weapon Media, we already spend a lot of time building communities in the Pacific Northwest. That's what we do. We actually build the League of Legends community up here and in BC, Canada. Work a lot with them. I help run tournaments. We have an online series called Judgment that we've been running for quite a bit. And it's been a lot of fun, as well as doing our other online tournaments and casting for other organizations. But HGL is a really cool league. I'm really excited to cast for these guys. And I know, at least from my experience rooting on Google last year, it's a lot of fun to have kind of like a company behind you or, a big group of people rooting for you, so should be fun. I hope they watch these and enjoy quite a bit. Looking at the teams, at least the summoner spells, as I'm looking over really quickly, nothing too crazy right now. They don't actually have to deal with a lot too much in lane matchups, so this is pretty solid. Looks like Karthus is not going for a cleanse. He's probably just going. It looks like he went for exhaust. Yeah. I'm okay with exhaust. Exhaust is good. There's going to be a lot of diving on teammates, and he can actually exhaust Katarina to reduce a lot of her damage when she comes in with her ult, so I don't mind that at all. Kai's going to run there, do as much damage, and wreak as much havoc as he can before stuff hits the fan. Oh, the black load-up screen. So I don't know about you, but I've actually had a lot of fun watching the League Championship Series. Fear and GG University just qualified, so they are now professional gamers. They get salary paid, all sorts of fun and happiness for those guys. Nothing but well wishes. Looks like my screen bugged out, so I'm gonna have to fix that. So we're gonna be a little bit slowly behind in the game. It's okay. It'll just look like the professionals do, where they change around all the icons. Might do that myself. Sounds good. Right, looks like we are loading in. Ooh, Uno Memento. I'm actually going to do some fancy shifting around. The secret behind the stuff that Riot makes look so smooth. I'm going to take care of that right now.
Welcome to Summoner's Rift.
All right. All right, welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go. Cersei Dyax versus NVIDIA. NVIDIA, the red team. Cersei Dyax, the blue team. Looks like we have a little bit of an invading here. And NVIDIA's just coming right in while Karthus is just laying down, trying to get some vision, trying to ward him away. And they are fully in the blue team's jungle. Let's see if they just try to come in here and ward it, or if they actually... Because a lot of teams will do is they'll do a really quick invade, and then they'll just ward the buff, check it out, then go to their own buff and cover it, and maybe come in and try to harass if they need to. But it looks like they're just running a train through, searching for if there's any stragglers that tried to come in the other way, see if they can catch up any team. They're just running the train right now through the enemy's base. Meanwhile, Cersei Dyax looks like they're poking around the blue buff of the enemy team. No early wards for either team went down except for this one right here on the edge. So they'll know if they exit out that way, but they've actually done the full train all the way around. And now they're heading back towards their blue buff. So we're actually going to have a showdown here, possibly. Garen running up to lane. So it would be... looks like it's going to be a 4v5. Full team running in here. They fully expect this is going down. There's no vision here. Neither team warded this. They should see the Mystic shot that just came through here. But Caitlyn trap is actually going to catch him out. So they're actually... Will they be able to get this, though? If he smites this and gets it, then, yeah, total win, actually. For Umumu right there, being able to pick up the blue buff. So really, really great play there. They stuck around, and there wasn't a full commit there by the red team. And NVIDIA is actually going to be hurting a little bit after that. Nocturne's jungle is going to be very, very behind, like I was talking about earlier. That really quick six that we were talking about maybe he was going to be able to do, not really going to be able to do anymore with his buff getting stolen like that. And Umumu should be relatively safe. They've actually warded a ton, it looks like, in here in the mid-river. It looks like in this mid-river here, as well as throwing down some traps, so they'll know if Nocturne tries to come over and steal the red in response. And he would actually need some help at this point, otherwise he'd take a lot of damage. So really, really good start for Cersei Dyax. Now, up top, we're going to have the... might be a little bit of a boring lane. We're going to have to see. I don't think Cid is going to mind champion being pushed... His lane being pushed into him at all, but either one shouldn't have too good of a time pushing in. Looks like Chasen taking a little bit of poke damage early, and that's kind of expected. The thing is, though, is Soraka actually is really, you know, that's what she's built for. She's built for sustain. She's built for actually taking on these kind of poke comps and trying to help her get through that. Caitlyn going around just really focused on CS, not even poking down her enemy. One thing that I might say is that with that extra range advantage, you kind of bunker in behind your creeps like what's going down right now. And then just take pot shots at your enemy. If you're not going to last hit here, then go in and take your pot shot because they are not going to outrange you. Mystic Shot's the only thing that will be able to poke you. And your auto attack range is 650, so it's way higher. And wow, Singe taking a lot of damage up here, trying to farm some of these. And there is the power cord poke damage on Chasen, but he should be getting some good heals off. So should be able to survive. In the mid lane, looks like Karthus actually been doing a pretty good job. He's low on mana here, but you know he has that flask. I don't know how many charges he has actually left on it, but he does have that flask, so he can actually get some mana there. It looks like he's using it right now. He's sustaining up. Meanwhile, Katarina just with boots pots, so she's going to have to rely on those to sustain. And actually, some good harass coming out from Karthus here. Looks like Nocturne's finally making his way top. We might see a gank come in there. We have a lot of pressure here from Garen, but it looks like it's... Nocturne's going to miss his chance. Just kind of push him out and give Sin some room to breathe and farm. Umumu did. Looks like he's just crossing mid right now. Katarina completely back. Took a lot of damage right there in that mid lane. So win right now for Karthus at this point. They're even in CS, but Karthus should be able to push up. 8 through all of her health potions. Meanwhile, Karthus has 4 health potions. Plus, he still has that flash, which he's going to be able to recharge, which that's a really common build now that we're seeing in a lot of games. And if you're playing mid... that's kind of That's kind of the way to go for a lot, you know, AD, whatever you're going. If you go Flask and then you go Health Potions, it's pretty much, like, unless you get ganked early, it's really hard to remove you from lane. And it looks like Singe is going to flip him in there. The Fear Tether, will it come in? Yes, it will. Slow going down. Nice stacking right there. I like that it's actually going to be Feared back, Ignite going down, but they're not going to have enough for this. And it looks like Kinston Ra is going to commit a little bit too hard right there. Take a few turret shots, but he doesn't really care. He's just going to back off and go about his business. Karthus first buyback. Looks like he wanted to go Catalyst here, but just didn't quite have enough money. Katarina looks like she's trying to go for possibly... We'll have to see. There's so many things you can go for early with Katarina. So we're just going to have to wait. We're just going to have to wait and see. Meanwhile, in the AD battle, Caitlyn's getting better. She hasn't actually focused a lot on harassment at all. In fact, Soraka's taken a lot of the harassment and punishment throughout this entire early laning phase, and Caitlyn's just been focused on farming. That's all she wants to do. Just going to probably save up and try to get that BF stored on her first back. Ooh, interesting bandage toss right there, trying to go over the wall, catch out I Want to Believe. And I gotta give props to this Karthus. He's actually doing a really, really good job with those lay wastes. Catching out a lot of damage on a Katarina. And there we go. Piltover Peacemaker coming in, doing a nice chunk of damage. Jatan trying to do a little poke, but it's not really gonna help out. And once. Yeah, Singed is level 6 now, so he can just turn that on, run around, and be perfectly fine at this point. You see right now a Mumu with that early steal, level 5. Versus a level 4 Nocturne who's, you know, come up for some ganks, haven't really got it. And of course they do have the timer, so great timing here. Actually gonna take the blue buff, and Nocturne's actually, I think he's going back to base at this point, so he's not even gonna have a chance at this. And they're pinging for it. They know something is up. They know they are missing and they did lose their blue buff. But in fact, they're gonna be really, really disappointed when this actually goes down. They actually pull in their bottom lane too. And yep, they know it is gone now, and Caitlyn just happy and farming. She's almost built up a 20 CS lead early in this game. I mean, it's pretty much almost there. 19 CS lead. If you look at her gold, she has about 300 advantage. And Garen coming in there, and that's going to be first blood. Singed a little too comfortable up in that top lane, but it's going to send him back. He's going to be able to get to buy out of this. Both lanes going pretty well so far. Early sights down for Soraka. That's going to give them a lot of ward control. They already have a lot of great warding going down. It looks like Sona, she hasn't gone backlit. So she's hit 6 first. She has her ult. The problem is, though, is they don't have any ward, so they can't really protect themselves if they do push out, or if they do decide to push out. And really just sitting on that fairy charm. And it looks like she is going to go back now. She is going to buy up. Probably going to go for that Sight Stone as well. But that's going to leave Ezreal... It's going to make it a little bit harder for Ezreal to farm up here. Because once they... If they do realize she's gone, they actually want to go a little bit aggressive. They can do it pretty easily against a support AD versus just the AD. Not going to happen. And just like Clockwork, Chase is doing a good job throwing down a ward right there for her... For his buddy. Might see a gank on mid here again. Likes this top bush. I would probably start warding it. Just barely misses, but is going to come in there, pop the ult. Lots of damage going down. She's not going to be able to get out of this, and that is going to be a kill for the mid lane. Looks like a Moon is going to be able to pick up that kill overall. But Karthus is just happy. More farming for him. More getting ahead. And right now, a quick 2-0 lead for Cersei Dyax. And as we look at that bottom line, 67 to 33 CS, and a mid 71 to 58. Quickly, we're really good. And, you know, when you die in lane, it's not that you die and your opponent just got that gold. It's also this, the lane pushing into your tower, losing a wave of creeps. It's just less CS that you can get. They got the CS they were supposed to get, and then they push in. You lose those creeps. That's kind of the denying. You know, a lot of people say there's no denying in League of Legends, like Dota has, where you can actually attack your own mains and get rid of them. That's kind of how you deny your opponent. You kill them, you force them out of lane, and then you push the wave into the tower, let the tower kill that experience and gold, and so they cannot get it. Again, she's taking a lot of damage with the silence coming down, exhaust coming down. Will they be able to follow us up? Sona's actually going to pop her ult to try to protect this Karthus ult. Requiem coming in. Meanwhile, Nocturne comes in, but he's 3v1, and that's not going to work out well for him. Nice attempt to try to save the teammate by Defrauder, but Karthus ult coming in there and ending Fools. And wow, this top lane going really, really well. Chatten must have felt really confident in this matchup, picking Garen, taking it against Sinj. Sinj just not quite prepared for it at this point. Looks like he's probably trying to get to some sort of catalyst if he can. But right now, just falling behind in CS, and the CS for Circe Dyke is looking very, very strong. Nocturne did his 6. We did see him come in there, but it was a little bit too little too late. Katarina even rotated over, thinking that maybe she could come down and make something happen. But there's some good warding actually going on by the blue team, and utilizing that sight stone from Soraka. And they probably either saw her or it was too late for her actually to be able to do anything in that scenario. She would be, again, going in piecemeal, you know, 3v1, something like that. And
red team's turret has been destroyed.
Really not quite stacked up yet. It looks like top turret is going to fall. And we're about the 11-minute mark. 11-minute mark's fine. 15 minutes used to be the old mark when you would take down turrets. But now it opens up the map a lot for their teammates. The only bonus for Captain Selfish is if he wants to be selfish and stay up in that top lane and get some gold, he actually can do that and farm up a little bit more. He has actually extra room to farm. But the problem is Garen's going to be loose on the map. He can actually go around for objectives and other nasty stuff. So map is a little bit more open for Circe Dyax at this point. It'd be interesting to see what they decide to do with that. Up about 4k exactly at this point, building a healthy lead. And it looks like Nocturne's coming in here. He's gonna want to have to pop his spell shield if he expects the bandage toss. As soon as he sees him turn around, looks like they're not gonna be able to get him. But Garen's coming up now, and that's actually a scary thing, because Garen's getting pretty beasty. He's almost at his fire cloak. We see lots of belts of health coming out here from Amumu and him. Ruby sightstone already for Soraka at this point, so she's sitting healthy. Actually has her biscuit, hasn't even used her biscuit yet, doesn't even need it because she's Soraka. That actually makes me wonder if she started biscuit and then didn't start, because she actually chugged, you know, she's using her health, and she must have used that early ward over the wall along with Karthus, I think, maybe early Karthus, maybe, because it started flask, maybe use that ward. I'm not sure. It'd be interesting if she got biscuit, didn't use biscuit as Soraka, but didn't get the third second ward. I think she laid it on the way out, on their way out. And oh wow, actually get a banish toss over after the blue buff. Gonna get the blue buff anyways. Great pickup here by Circe Dyax, and I want to believe running for his life now, trying to dodge those laywaste. Aaron takes a turret hit here, trying to really just chase and bully her around. Katarina run for life at this point. And Captain Selfish turning on the ult, going to get a lot of his health back there, going to regen up. Try to stay in lane, sustain. Might want to walk around and pick up some of this jungle in the meantime if he can, or go back and buy if he's close to his catalyst. He actually has enough for his catalyst if he wanted to go back for that. Looks like he is going to do that. And it looks like blue team, seeing that they've actually backed off Singe, they feel really confident here. It's an early smite, but that's okay. No one was coming for that one. But in case, you know, you did the early smite and then maybe a true shot barrage came in or something, that could be a little bit scary, but it looks like they probably already saw that go by or be used for farming, so no harm, no foul right there for Circe Dyax. And Circe Dyax have to a pretty strong lead here. 6k now and climbing. So they're making a lot of good moves. And Garen's like, no, this is my red buff. But once help comes, we might see him back off. But it looks like Karthus is going to come up as well. Karthus' ult is up. So if they want to make something happen, they can do this. Exhaust actually going down on I Want to Believe. Paranoia coming in. They're trying to turn this around. Karthus is going to turn on Lay Waste and the Defile. And it's going to deal massive damage. And it looks like they're going to back out of there. Katarina coming in, trying to get her ult off and do some serious damage. But now Karthus just sitting outside of this fight, just putting in as little damage as he can. Double kill for Garen coming in here. Kellish, will he be able to get out of this? Singe basically is going all in right now just to get a kill if he can. Garen can let this go because Karthus is going to lock it up with that Requiem. And now they can actually push this mid lane if they want, and probably take mid lane turret and bottom lane turret if they really want, because all they have is support right now to try to defend this. Looks like Ezreal even falling possibly in the bottom lane at some point. Didn't see him coming to that last fight, so... Yeah, it looks like he died actually back a little bit. Go see if I can go back and see what happened there. Actually, he was probably low. I'm guessing he was low and actually died to the Requiem, probably. Maybe. No, that was actually pretty close, but... The fact that he died back here makes me wonder. Ace in the hole or Requiem, one of the two. Red team's turret has been destroyed. Yeah, so that's two turrets down. And actually, flash after, and Soraka's all in on support-on-support battle, getting in there. No AD backup needed. I got this, don't worry. So Nocturne level 7, Amumu level 9. So Amumu has two levels on Nocturne right now due to that early game that we saw from them. That strong the take. It doesn't have a lot of more CS, but has the kill, has an assist. Nocturne with two assists, but essentially has about over 1k lead on him in gold. So really, really strong jungle actually coming out for Cersei Dyax as well. And their CS is pretty consistent. 129, 125, 103. Looking very, very strong across the board. Singed just had some trouble up top. Bottom lane's been kind of behind. I'd actually like to give big props to I Want to Believe in the mid lane, because he's actually been able to stand up quite well, even though he's been under a lot of harass, being pushed out of lane. Actually, he's rotated a lot of times to try to help out his team. So big props to actually being able to hang tough, at least in the CS, with his opponent. But the problem becomes you have, you know, five assists and three kills. On the other hand, for Karthus. And you just see all that damage come in on I Want to Believe, and just has to run away, has to buy back, has to go back. And Garen could have possibly thought about cruise missile in there. It'd be pretty hard. I Want to Believe has a lot of outs. Hushumpo. Aerith's Wolf and Defrauder right now. Trying to stay safe down here. They've actually warded up right here to try to make sure that they can actually farm this bottom lane without someone sneaking in on them and killing them in lane. It's something you have to do once you lose these outer turrets and you're kind of behind like this. You've lost all your outer turrets. It's not safe to actually be very far in this game. And you know, Ezreal could throw out a Mystic Shot there or something to put out a little bit of damage. It's not going to help him that much. Nice little bit of a juke there, but I Want to Believe. Now just sitting here defending middle. It looks like most lanes are pushing up now, and really this is what Cirrus Dyax just kind of needs to do to finish out. They're gonna see this rotation by right now, but if this rotation didn't come in, they would be completely safe. And another kill top by Chad. Chad is owning the top lane right now. It is his lane to have, and I Want to Believe wants to go for a kill, just waiting on cooldowns, waiting for some teammates to possibly come here. Actually decides to back off. Amumu is coming in here as well as Karthus, so that would actually be a lot of trouble. And a fight for Blue Buff is probably going to go down. It looks like I Want to Believe goes in there and just puts all his damage up front onto Karthus. Karthus being chased down. True Shot Barrage comes in. They will be able to kill Karthus, but Karthus is still going to be able to Requiem. That's going to deal a massive damage to the enemy team. Going to be able to pick up Sona. Airbus was very, very low. Ace in the hole. Oh, almost kills Katarina. Katarina takes it. If she hadn't have taken that, we would have for sure dead Ezreal. He hopefully has Arcane Shift. Does it a little bit early. Actually, Bandage tosses to minions. I actually thought Amumu had that if he just bandage tossed right towards Ezreal after he arcane shifted early. Soraka a little bit of trouble here by Singed, but Garen coming in, trying to protect him, will be able to juke enough. Ignite going down, poison's going down. This is very, very close. Heals coming in at the last second, trying to stay alive. Singed just needs one more toss, and that should be it. I think that might get her. It's going to be close, and yes, Singed will be able to do it. Use that extra speed, and he should be able to get out of this just fine. It would be nice if that silence... would fully get rid of that poison, but do it. So nice little fight back there by Nvidia. He will pick up a kill on the support. Not too bad. A little bit of a morale kill right there. So, but 11k lead built by Cersei Dyax at this point. Very, very strong opening. Execution got the first few kills. Great steal in the jungle. It's kind of put the Nocturne behind, which is something you have to be very, very careful. And I like that Nvidia, you know, kind of had a strategy going in this. They wanted to go for that invade. Oh, no, the red buff is going to get stolen. And really, there's no chance right now for Nocturne to fight that at all. And just when things are going bad, sometimes they get worse. And just looking at the items overall, I mean, you look at the disparity between Katarina and Karthus. Katarina has Haunting Guys. She has her Sork Boots. Looks like working on Abyssal Scepter. But on the other hand, you see Karthus, and Karthus has Rabadons, Rod of Ages, and Sork Boots. So he's a lot more tankier, has a lot more AP. And all that was close to possibly a steal. Looks like Garen's actually going to pick up the kill on that. Didn't even have a Moomoo over there. But Red Team needs to run, and Sona's probably going to... No, it looks like they're not going to have a Banish Toss there. They need to be really careful if someone gets caught by a Moomoo. Because if anybody gets caught by a Moomoo, it's pretty much over for one target. They can easily focus them down very, very quickly. Soraka being a little bit too aggressive now. They might get a pickoff here, but they need to be careful. They don't get baited in. Just, oh, wow. If that actually worked out, if that Banish Toss landed and we had a Moomoo ult, that would have been probably... That would have been four dead NVIDIA players right there. Sin's trying to play around, but you can see, you know, when you get a little bit behind his Sin and he doesn't really have his items, he just got his Rod of Ages. He's not tanky enough to really deal with what's going on here. And looks like Katarina coming in here. Great stun by Amumu right there, canceling the ult of Katarina. And now they're just... They tried to dive in there, but he's not able to deal enough damage. And they keep trying to retreat. People keep staying alive. But that is going to be a picked up kill onto Ezreal by Karthus, and he still has Requiem up. That's the scary part. So two down. They got a four man push in mid. One, we have Caitlyn down bottom. They're just gonna keep cleaning up, keep dealing damage. Easy peasy at this point. Looks like Ezreal just trying to catch up, going for some sort of Triforce at this point, possibly. But that's not gonna help him. Triforce. It's a pretty good item if you get it early on, but the later you go, it's not quite as good. It's really expensive, and it has a lot of smaller components, which are really good for you as you build up. But for the most part at this point, I mean, props to Erebus Wolf for trying to play from behind and make something happen, but the disparity between him and what Caitlyn's rocking right now is just, it's a big gulf. And what they need from their team, really, they just don't really have enough damage anywhere on their team. You saw, and the other problem, too, is a little bit disjointed in their fights. You know, Katarina's going in and doing something. The Nocturne's going in and doing something. It's kind of a theme we've seen. Overall, there's never one big focused attack or effort to take someone out, besides Soraka, I guess. It's more just kind of layering of ults and damage. That's really not enough at this point, because seriously, Dyax has built a pretty healthy lead right now. About 15k. So seriously, Dyax, the thing, you know, they can continue the split push they were doing, but they are really, really far ahead. They see Ezreal's out of position. Looks like Garen's actually just heading top. They really can just push in and poke. They actually have that advantage. As long as they're mindful, protect their carries, they should be able to close out this game if they really want to. Their item advantage is such to the point that there's no way that NVIDIA can really even teamfight them at all. Without Garen, I mean, they'd have a pretty good shot. They're 5v4 right now. If they go in, take out Karthus, get out of his area of effect, or maybe take out Caitlyn even, that would be best case scenario. They have a pretty good shot at it, but the time that they have to do that is basically the clock is Garen traversing the map right now. Garen doing a good job. He's doing what you need to do later in the games to win. He's actually pushing the lane. We see Caitlyn going down bottom doing the same. You want to keep your lanes pushed, because otherwise you have to keep doing this to keep your lanes pushed off of you. Now, the good news is that the blue team has all their outer turrets up, so naturally all the lanes are going to push for them. Eventually, though, there will be a lane that builds up enough that it'll actually kill your tower. The minions will just kill the tower. Uh-oh, we have a fight up top, and we have a fight down low. It looks like the red team has decided to go up top, try to protect Singe. It is just Garen up here right now, but he has so much health. He's so far ahead, and he's so tanky. And there we have the Paranoia trying to come in. Dive trying to go into Karthus. Defender's going to be taken down. And now we have crazy damage. Aaron's still getting healed by Soraka. And props to Katarina for trying to get there and make some damage happen. But Garen is just way too tanky and out of control right now. Black Cleaver on Garen, as far as I know, every tick, you know, when he does his spin, every tick of that actually applies the Black Cleaver. So as he's doing that to your entire team's getting Black Cleavered which is pretty strong. It looks like we just have a 1v1 up top. We can actually go back and check that out right now, I guess.
Red team's turret has been destroyed.
Yeah, it looks like Ezreal's come over here, tries to go ahead and do some damage, but actually there's a lot of creeps there, and once he gets out of range, just takes that crit damage, does not realize the ace level comes in, no protection. And really just props to the entire CRC Dyax team has just played a really crisp game. And, you know, there's nothing really, you can't entirely fault NVIDIA entirely with what's gone wrong with this game, because CRC Dyax just played a really solid game. They had a strategy coming in. They actually, you know, they responded to their buff possibly getting stolen really, really well. And just have executed throughout this game completely, you know, solid. They've made pretty much no mistakes for the most part. Garen 7-0-2, Karthus 8-1-7. A very, very strong play for both those players, and they've been able to keep up their farm the entire time. You know, a lot of times when teams get into this, they get ahead, they get in this roaming phase, they actually a lot of times can actually get away from it. Oh, we have a big team fight coming on here. It is 5v3, and Karthus is still just wrecking people right now. He's going to still be alive after he dies. Probably going to still pick up a kill. Probably pick up another one. Requiem coming in is going to end a lot of lives right there. And will... Oh, nice little juke trying to get away from this. But will, I want to believe, be able to get out of this? Should be able to. Has that turret to protect her. Katarina is going to be safe. But as you can see right there, 5v3... And they really can't win. That's how out of control this game is kind of being. So really, seriously, Dyax can just go in, press in pretty much any turret they want to, and end up this game. So good game. Props to them. Very, very clean game by them. Looks like Abyssal Scepter was finished for Katarina. But I mean, just the disparity items right now is, this is one of those games where it just gets away from you, and there's nothing you can do. It's almost kind of makes me wish there was a best of three sometimes, and you know, and sometimes it's just team confidence. You know, when you have something happen like they did their, you know, NVIDIA had a plan, they did their invade, came back around, came to blue buff. They weren't decisive enough. That's probably what I would say. And neither team really warded their buffs to check, like. If blue team, you know, when Karthus did that ward over the wall, instead if, you know, they had a Mumu over there and a Mumu warded, or they had someone ward blue buff so they could see red team leave, I mean, they pretty much guessed that might be what happened. They were pretty cautious when they were heading over to the red blue buff. They would have been fine. But red, when they go through, they either need to ward the blue buff or they need to ward their own buff before they take off and leave and run around through there and go for that invade. They want to be really aggressive in the middle, so they probably couldn't have done that. So they should have at least had some wards in there to at least see what was going on, or thrown a ward when they were heading for their own blow up just to check on the status. And that way they actually would have been pretty solid to try to make something happen there, but they weren't decisive enough. Amumu was able to get the blue buff, and at that point, it's just a really lost cause, because then you had Singe getting to top lane super late. He's behind Garen, who was already running up lane and was completely safe. And yeah, and they have to completely back off here. There's no real option to defend against Blue's push. The best bet they have, actually, is probably just their Nexus turrets having two turrets instead of one. But even then, I don't even think they can really defend a Baroned up team that's this far ahead at this point. And we're talking 22k or 23k gold lead. And they're just, you know, this kind of, the way they're ending this, I mean, they could just run in there and just massive death kill everybody. But the way this is kind of getting finished off very systematically is kind of just a good picture of how they played this entire game. Won their lanes, played super solid, capitalized very, very early in the game, just kept it going. Now we see the fight finally go down. Looks like Crescendo's finally going to come in, but that you can just see the entire team melt. There's so much damage for the mini team. Karthus has crazy damage at this point, picks up a triple kill, and there might pick up a quadra kill if anyone is so nice. And there it is, quadra kill for Karthus. Can't get the Pentakazali dead. And that is going to be the game. Congrats to CRC Dyax, the library technology company taking down NVIDIA. Congrats to them. Again, I am Pato. This is the HGL League, a league full of companies just like this. And great game. Both teams, thanks for letting me cast you. I am Pato from Razor Weapon Media, and I hope you guys have a nice day. And congrats on your guys' win, Seriously Dax, and best luck in your next game on NVIDIA.